That's Nick.
And that's Joseph. And today we're here to talk about The Unforgivable, which Netflix released theatrically in some venues November 24th, 2021, and it will be available to stream December 10th, 2021. It is the sophomore feature of Nora Fingscheidt, whose first film, System Crasher, competed at Berlin in 2019, which I did see.
You did see it. Mm-hmm. Did you like it?
It's interesting. It's better than this film.
Oh.
Notably, this is based on a UK three-episode miniseries called Unforgiven from 2009. Originally, it was meant to be an Angelina Jolie project about a decade ago. But here we are today.
Oh, okay, the basic story revolves around a lady named Ruth, played by Sandra Bullock.
Yeah.
All right. So we see Ruth being released from prison. She served 20 years for the murder of a sheriff. Okay, the circumstances around the murder are, she was holed up in a house somewhere in Washington with her younger sister, who's a five-year-old. And we see her screaming and shouting with the sheriff's office outside the house and Child Protective Services outside. And she's saying, you're not going to take my sister. We are not leaving this house. They're telling her you're being evicted. She's telling them she has a gun. Next thing we know, the sheriff is shot dead. Mm-hmm. So that's why Ruth spent 20 years. And actually, the 20 years was early because of good behavior. All right. As soon as Ruth gets out of prison, she wants to find her sister. The sister was adopted by another family and has a no contact order against Ruth, which we'll get into. All right, so a couple of things. The two sons, the children of the dead sheriff, we meet them, and one of them is very affected by the death of his father and holds a lot of resentment towards Ruth. And he knows that she's being released, so he's following her around. And he is talking like he wants to do something to her, like get revenge. The other brother, the more attractive one, he's more laid back about it. Like, what are we gonna do? It's already like consumed so much of our lives, like we just need to let it go. But the more homely brother is having an affair.
Their names are Keith and Steve, if that helps. Keith is the older brother and Steve is the younger brother.
Well, which one's older?
Tom Guiry as Keith and Steve is played by Will Pullen.
But I don't know which one's which.
Keith is the younger one that I keep referring to as more attractive.
Oh, he's the younger one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Keith. The two
brothers... Oh, sorry, Steve.
I'll see. The homely one is having an affair with the more attractive one's wife. And the more attractive one catches them. So, of course, he's upset. And then he starts thinking, like, our shit is fucked up because of what happened to our dad, which caused our mom to have a drinking problem. So now he's mad, and now he wants to do something to Ruth. So there's that happening. Ruth, we'll get into how, but she secures an attorney to assist her in meeting her sister. And the best this attorney can do is say, I got you a meeting with her adoptive parents, and we'll see what they say. So they have a meeting. It's very predictable in that it goes terribly. So her sister's name is Katherine. Mm-hmm. Okay, the adoptive family, they have a biological daughter. That daughter overhears her parents talking, and a big plot point is that Ruth wrote her sister like a bunch of letters while she was incarcerated. So this sister, the
Emily,
the biological, the adoptive family, reads the letters and reaches out to Ruth. They meet. It seems like she takes a liking to her, and she says, well, your sister is going to be performing a recital this afternoon at 4 o'clock in this place if you want to just go look at her. Okay. The good-looking brother,
Steve,
he decides that to get revenge, he wants to hurt her loved one, her sister. So we see that he's kidnapped someone and has called Ruth to say, like, I have your sister. You need to meet me down by the Cuddy Sty and we can figure this out. She goes, with the assistance of her attorney's wife, who's played by Viola Davis. And Viola, immediately, when she drops her off at this, like, random, like, construction site, she realizes that this isn't right and calls the police. So while... when Ruth goes inside, Steve is there with the girl he kidnapped. But he kidnapped the wrong bitch. He kidnapped the biological sister of the adoptive family, not Ruth's actual sister. So... the cops come, she's able to get out of the house, or the factory, wherever they are. The end. But there's a big plot twist in that we find out that it wasn't Ruth who shot the cop.
She didn't shoot the sheriff.
She didn't shoot the sheriff. Her 5-year-old sister shot the sheriff, and she took the fall and spent 20 years in prison for it, for some reason. Which we never find out. The end.
Yes.
Oh, I was very frustrated watching this movie.
Yes, because there are a lot of things... for a film that's about a woman that wants to be a carpenter, they bailed her a shithouse. Because nothing measures up. The casting seems completely off. And there's really no character development.
No.
Which suggests this is material that would have been... more beneficially laid out in a miniseries. You mentioned it should have the feeling of Mayor of Easttown.
Yes.
But, which is funny, because this is set primarily in Seattle, and I think maybe because of how the brothers were acting, this felt like Boston to me.
It did, yeah.
And a lot of things about maybe the U.S. legal system that don't make sense, or things that need explanation. Going back to the setup of where this murder of the sheriff happened, where we really need to understand how it was that Sandra Bullock, presumably playing a 20-year-old in the flashback sequences, is insistent upon not exiting the house with the child. And I don't know if they're... because we get details that her father died and left them orphaned and she's taking care of the sister. And I don't know if this maybe had some kind of dimensions like, say, the film Country with Jessica Lange and Sam Shepard, which is all about property loss and FHA. Like a very Midwestern type drama. I don't
FHA?
Know. Yeah, the Federal Housing Administration.
Oh.
Yeah, that's from 1984. Anyway.
I don't know why I thought it was like farming or something.
But that film went into... I kept thinking we were going to return to something pertinent there, that we really needed to understand how they ended up holding this house when they should have just left. But
I think, yes, like that really threw me off. Like Sandra Bullock looks like a woman. She looks like a middle-aged lady in this movie, and she is in real life. So then, of course, you subtract 20 years, and it's like she is a whole-ass adult when this incident happens. And like you said, we don't understand at all how she got in this situation or why she thinks it's a good idea that when the sheriff and Child Protective Services are knocking at your door, you are threatening them with a gun, thinking this is going to end well.
Yeah.
And like you said, how the hell did they even get that bad?
We need to know how that happens with a little more finesse.
Or the actor playing Ruth needed to be younger so then I can understand, like, oh, her sister, the 5-year-old sister, Ruth, is maybe like a 20-year-old. And so she didn't know. But Sandra Bullock in the flashback looks like a woman in her late 30s. So it just doesn't even look or make sense.
And we need to understand why. And of course, that throws out the age gap of the sisters, because we're constantly distracted by Sandra Bullock's casting. And then the legal ramifications of her being convicted for killing the sheriff are that the judge placed a no contact order. But this sister, this young woman, Katherine, is now 25 years old and has no idea about it, which seems to throw the legality of this into chaos.
Which I think, again, the actor playing Ruth needed to be younger, and I think her prison sentence maybe should have been slightly shorter. And you had mentioned that in the miniseries it is a little shorter.
Which I haven't seen, but in the synopsis I read, the woman served 15, 16 years.
Because... It just doesn't make sense that this 25-year-old would now have this... I don't know if a no-contact order is the same as a restraining order, but it seems like... because the sister, Katherine, is kept in the dark. Oh, we didn't mention. The sister has, we're told, has PTSD, so she doesn't remember her sister at all. She doesn't remember anything before the incident. So it's like, how do you have a no-contact order with someone who you don't know exists and your family won't tell you about it? Like,
and the contrivances of the script have, the day that Sandra Bullock is released, the adult daughter, Katherine, played by Eileen Franciosi.
Sister.
A sister. See, in my mind, I kept like wanting her to be a daughter. Total wasted role for Eileen Franciosi, who's magnificent in Jennifer Kent's The Nightingale, by the way. Like, what she's doing here, I have no idea. But she drifts off and falls asleep and gets in a car accident the same day that her mother's released, which is as contrived as, so apparently Ruth is skilled as a carpenter and had built this hutch in their family home. And she goes back to, you know, what's it, the murder site where Vincent D'Onofrio and Viola Davis now live with their two children. And she looks disheveled as hell, and he invites her in the house after she mentioned that she used to live there and built some of the house. And we can get into that if you want.
Well, I just think that's the next most ridiculous thing, is that this, like, crazy lady shows up, and, you know, Viola Davis and her husband, who's an attorney, like, they are intelligent, well-kept looking people. Why they think it would be a good idea to let this crazy looking lady into their house?
And then he happens to be a lawyer that takes on her work, her case pro bono.
Ugh, I thought that was so poorly done.
And what, so Viola Davis also has nothing to do in
nothing.
This.
She has one scene that is the result of construction workers coming, and then she kind of, because when Ruth, Sandra Bullock's character, first goes to the house, she says, like you mentioned, that she built something in the house. So when the other construction workers come, Viola says, like, oh, do you know the old owners and this thing? And they're like, yeah, you didn't hear about this sheriff getting shot? And then he says, oh, you don't know about Ruth? And then, so then Viola knows the truth.
The truth about Ruth.
Then, when her husband comes home, Viola goes off on him. Then, when Ruth can't get a hold of her attorney, or this man, she visits the house in a really awkward scene, because it's so inappropriate. And then Viola comes out and starts screaming at her. And I just thought, what a waste of Viola's acting.
It's a waste of Viola's acting, and then that scene is so awkward because they reconcile, and then because we have to get to the denouement where Viola drives her to where the girl is held hostage. But the scene that brings, is especially frustrating for me with Viola, is when she confronts Vincent D'Onofrio about why he's helping this convicted killer. No, we needed to back up. She needed to clap at her husband about why you let this crazy looking woman inside the house in the first place. The fact that he's a lawyer and wants to help someone in need.
Okay, the next thing I really didn't like is Ruth's parole officer, who's played by Rob Morgan.
Yes.
Who I know from Don't Look Up.
Which is releasing on Netflix the same day as The Unforgivable. You can have a Rob Morgan double feature.
And our review's posting on the 10th.
Yeah, you can put that up now if you want.
Oh, the review will be posted before this video comes out. I don't understand why he's so mean to her.
Yeah, he's very aggressive, and he's, you're a cop killer everywhere you go. You need to be a cop killer.
Yeah, you need to just get that into your head and come to terms that you're just a killer, and no one's ever going to see you as anything but a killer. And I just didn't understand why that character needed to be like that.
And I think the two brothers are especially rudimentary and just frustrating, because they just play like white trash.
Everything about these characters is so basic to me. It's one-dimensional. It's very obvious.
And then there's Bernthal is playing her ubiquitous love interest, who happens to be a convict as well. And
there's a scene where, because Ruth works at like a fish packing plant, and the word gets out that she killed the sheriff. So then there's some other employee whose dad is a cop and whoops her ass, saying, like, my dad's a cop. I just feel like...
Which, again, also made this seem like, this feels like Boston in my mind.
I don't have any other notes. I just was so disappointed. I think this could have been a really engaging... I felt nothing because Ruth's behavior is so frustrating, but then because the character is so flat, it's like, I don't care about this lady. And then her sister, all we know about her is that she seems like she has emotional issues, but she also seems like that when we visit her as a five-year-old, like in the flashbacks. So we really don't have any background on this sister and why you thought that it was a good idea to take the fall for her.
And why D'Onofrio thinks it's a good idea for this obsessive woman to meet these parents. Yes. But, like, with only him to mediate?
That was actually my last note, was that the meeting that he orchestrates is so inappropriate. Like, he's smart enough to know that this woman is not, emotionally prepared to have this meeting.
With the parents, which we didn't even bring up who plays them, are Richard Thomas from the Waltons.
John Boy.
And Linda Emond, who... Yeah, there's just so much that doesn't... It's like so much needs to be recalibrated based on who they... The star they cast and the culture shift of the original. Which was written by a very notable British writer, Sally Wainwright. This...
I didn't mention that the very last shot of the film is... So we're made to understand, and so is Ruth, that her sister, Katherine, doesn't remember her. So when the cops come and save the day, the family comes to visit the other sister who's in an ambulance, and Catherine's there, and Ruth is there with her parole officer now, and Katherine turns, like they both turn at the same time and look at each other, and then Katherine slowly walks over and gives her sister a hug, the end. So I'm assuming that the sister only knows who that is because on the drive over to the site, the parents must have explained, like, what is happening. But that was, I felt like that should have been a moment where I felt something, and I didn't because it's...
Well, and, you know, we have three screenwriters that worked in this adaptation. Peter Cragg, known for Bloodfather and The Town, Hilary Seitz for Eagle Eye and the Insomnia remake, and Courtenay Miles making her feature debut, but wrote episodes of Mindhunter. So very, strong genre component in the background for these three writers, which maybe explains why it seems like a lot of corners were cut regarding everything else. And also the look and tone and mood of the film just doesn't fit. This was shot by Guillermo Navarro, who has lensed three notable Guillermo del Toro films, such as Kronos and Pan's Labyrinth and Pacific Rim. So...
I didn't like the look of the film, but that's the least of this movie's problems.
I agree, but it's just it really doesn't get anything right on any fronts. Like, it's just an oddly shaped house, if you will.
The only thing that made me feel something is the fact that I'm so frustrated with this character of Ruth. And then when we find out that she didn't kill the sheriff, there's a moment where it's like, oh.
Well, I mean, okay. That is a good twist, but we need to understand how ballistics tests weren't run. She wouldn't have had a gunpowder residue on her. And also, yes, a five-year-old, there would be repercussions. She would have been charged with something creating this environment where this happened, but, not convicted of being a killer. You are robbing this five-year-old of the therapy that they probably need after that experience. And that it's just...
I'm just very unsatisfied with this film. What would you give it?
I'd give it 2 out of 5.
I want to give it 1.5, but I guess I'll give it 2 out of 5.
I mean, it's nice. I like Sandra Bullock as a performer. And Viola Davis. This is Sandra's first thing since
Bird Box.
The cult classic from Netflix.
I'm sure people will like it. Anyone who's, I don't know. People relate to aspects of stories like this and they overlook the fact that it's just not well done.
I feel like this would have been a great vehicle in the 1980s when they actually took care for women's roles in constructing characters.
Anything else?
No.
Bye.